tell you guys something. I absolutely hate. I hate when somebody will tell a kid. I don't want to say kid. You teenagers, you know, almost adults. They'll say, "You don't know how hard life is. You're just a kid." They say that, right? This is why I hate that. Because they don't know my story, right? They don't know your story. They don't know what you've been through, what you're going through, what it's like to go home. And sometimes they do, and they're just saying something that's ignorant, right?
Yeah.
Life is hard. My life was hard. I was talking to my man over here, Gideon. He said, "I can tell you've been through a lot. I have been through a lot. I'm a light-skinned Mexican." Let me clarify. I'm a light-skinned Mexican with the brown eyes, but I'm also half white. So that becomes a problem. Let me tell you why. All the Mexican kids at school said, "You're just a white boy." So they didn't want to hang out with me. I didn't want to hang out with the white kids, because it's not like today when you have white kids who like any culture. Where I was at, all the white kids, for the most part, liked punk rock. I didn't like punk rock. I liked hip-hop. Let me tell you why else my life was hard. I was extremely fat. We had Leanna come up here. She shared her testimony. I was about 4 feet tall, 170 pounds. That's this and like that. I was huge. I was a big kid, a big boy. Played football. Hated sports, though. Let me tell you why I hated sports. I like doing athletic stuff. I like riding my bike. I like going swimming. And when I say swimming, I don't mean like kicking by the pool. I mean doing laps. I like going to the gym and working out. But I'm not an athlete. I've never been that good at playing sports. I'm just average. So the kids on the team that I played with, they would just make fun of me all day. They tell me how I'm just a second stringer, even though when I played football, I started. But still, they said I belong in the second string. They said, "Man, you're just fat. Man, you can't get any girls," because that's when you're a teenager, that's all you think there is, right? Just trying to get the ladies when you're a young man. My parents were not together. My parents have never been together since from the time I was born. My life has been hard. But I'll never forget something that my grandma told me. I don't know how old I was, but I was pretty young. I was probably like early middle school or pre-middle school. She said, you know, my man over there was talking about the grandma's hands when the grandma just prays for you. I don't know if some of you guys might have that kind of story. She said, "God promised me that you're going to serve him." My grandma's the only Christian in my family. Well, now, at the time of me, not anymore, thank God. She was the only Christian in my family. My mom's not a Christian, although she would say she is. My dad is definitely not a Christian. My pops, I love him, but he doesn't know what it's like to lead me, so I didn't know how to be led to be what a man should be. But my grandma said, God has a promise on your life, and you're going to do something. You're going to serve him. It took me 16 years to finally hear the gospel, surrender to Jesus. And after that, I started walking with him. And from the time I was 16 to the time I was 23, God has done powerful things. I'm not just a speaker, but I'm also a poet. I do spoken word. Anyone know what spoken word is? Yeah, I do spoken word. I've done it in front of crowds of 10, and I've done it in crowds in front of 1,000. And that's not a joke. I have spoken as a pastor in front of up to 600, 700, 800 people. I graduated with my bachelor's degree. Not only did I get my bachelor's degree, first one in my family, by the way, but I got one of the highest honors that my school offers. I have a really good GPA. I've seen God move in powerful ways in my life. Guess what? I'm also married. Just a few years ago, that would have been impossible. I was terrified of marriage because my mom has been married and it didn't work out. My dad has been married, but not happily. I was terrified of getting married. God restored in me and said, "You can be a husband. You can be faithful. You can do great things in leading this woman." I got married. God has done these great things in my life. Then I finished school and I became a pastor. When I became a pastor, I started working at this church that Fresh Youth Ministry, no kids, which I didn't know because I wasn't told that. I met a couple kids. Turned out that my pastor lied to me, said these kids come to the church, but they didn't. Long story short, this church was very unhealthy, and I had to leave that church. And once I left that church, I said, God, you've done all these great things in my life and brought me to this point. Guess what I do now, where I work at? I make sandwiches for people at a minimum wage job, Monday through Friday, sometimes Saturdays. I say, God, this is what you're giving me now, but I served you, but I did all this stuff. And here I am stuck here making sandwiches every day, barely getting by, paying bills. Because let me tell you, real life has big bills. I'm here to talk to you guys today about Ishmael. And you guys, who was here yesterday? Pretty much everybody. Pastor Phil talked about Ishmael, right? And what was the thing that he said about that what happened in Ishmael's life? What happened? God what? God heard him, right? God heard when Ishmael was crying out. What was interesting about that story is that just a few chapters earlier, we're going to look at the word, but I just want to explain this to you. A few chapters earlier, Hagar is his mom, right? She gets kicked out of the family while Ishmael is still growing inside of her. She gets kicked out of the family, and she's in the wilderness. And she's out there, and she's crying. She doesn't know what to do, right? In the Bible, whenever it talks about the wilderness, it's talking about alienation. It's talking about feeling alone. It's talking about the struggle. It's talking about how hard things can be. That's what the wilderness is in the Bible. And she's sitting out there, and her struggle is real. She just got kicked out of her family. And God shows up, right, and he tells her. He puts a promise, not on her life necessarily, but on Ishmael. And he says, Ishmael is going to have a lot of descendants from her line. Ishmael is going to have a lot of kids. At that time, that is a really powerful promise. Because everything depended on your family line, right? So, God makes this promise to her, and she says, he says, I will name the child Ishmael. Now, here is why this is important. Ishmael means, does anyone know what it means? Anybody? What does it mean? Yeah. Not quite, but good try. That's actually Abraham's name. The reason why that's important is because Pastor Phil's point was God hears, right? Ishmael means God hears. By the time he was being formed in the womb, God made a promise to him. God has made a promise to you from the entire time that you've been being formed in your mother's womb. Before you even walked this earth, God had a promise on your life. Do you believe that?
Yes.
It was for Ishmael. So Ishmael eventually is born, and I'm sure his mom told him, there's this promise, there's this great promise on your life. These great things are going to happen. About 16 years later, still nothing has happened. And now his dad has another son. And guess what? This son is the one who was going to inherit everything from his father. His name is Isaac. And that's the way God always intended it to be. But because Abraham and Sarah decided to switch things up, they kind of almost messed everything up. Ishmael, I'm sure, would have been jealous. Does anyone have younger brothers, younger sisters, or older brothers, older sisters? Have you ever been jealous of them? This guy's lying right here. I'm just kidding. I don't know your story, man. But I know I could relate to that. Because after my dad got married, his wife eventually had a kid, little boy, Ugo. My dad would tell me, Ugo's going to be a great athlete. He's going to play football. He's going to play all the sports. He's going to this. He's going to that. And my dad I felt like rubbing it in my face that I was that great. Yeah, I played the sports, but I was just average. My dad put all this promise into my other brother, and then his wife has another kid, and then my dad starts saying, this is real. He says, I think Nick is going to be better than all of you guys at sports because he's playing with the older kids. You know, Ugo, he goes and hangs out with his friends, and when Nick comes back, He's going to be better as he gets older. He's going to be like the top star when he's in high school. A little jealousy came up in my heart. So what do you do when you're jealous of someone? All right, you just get angry at your little brother. What do? You pick on him. Come on, let's be real. You pick on him. I would pick on my little brother. Treat him a certain way. I loved him, but I was jealous. So I pick on him. Ishmael, I'm sure, knew that Isaac was the promised son that God originally intended. So what does Ishmael do? He picks on Isaac. Starts picking on him. And Sarah, which is Isaac's mom, looks over and sees this happening. And she goes up to Abraham, her husband, and she says, that other boy and your slave wife need to go. Kick them out of our family. They will get nothing. And Abraham is like, oh man, I don't know if I can do this. But God shows up, says, it's the best thing to do. Send them away. Now the first time when God showed up to Hagar when she was in the wilderness, she was sitting by a well. That well is important. The second time, Abraham comes up to her. He said, here's some bread, here's some water. And this little thing, bread probably barely hold any water. He says, go into the wilderness. And they go into a wilderness called the wilderness of Beersheba. Here's why this is important. Beersheba was known for not having hardly any water. And the only way you could find water is if you found a well that was dug up. We don't know nothing about that, right? We just go to the store and buy an Aquafina and roll out and it's all good. That wasn't the case back then. And who knows what we need more than anything to survive? More than food?
Water.
Water, right? We desperately need water. If you do not, what is that? That's not what he said. I don't know. We desperately need water. We need it. We have to have it. We can't go more than a few days without drinking water. We can go tons of days without eating. But if we don't have water, we'll die, right? So he gives this stuff to Hagar, sends her away with her son, and they go out to the wilderness. They run out of water, no more food. She's like, well, this is the end. How many times do we know that God has put a promise on our life and we forget it, right? She goes out there, she says, this is the end. She gets her son. By this time, Ishmael's around your age. He's like at least 16 years old, and she says, come, you know, sit underneath that bush. I'm going to go away over here because I don't want to watch you die. I'm not trying to see that. She goes away and she's crying. I remember Pastor Phil said that God heard the voice of Ishmael crying out, not Hagar, even though the Bible says Hagar is the one that's crying. So God comes out and he's talking to her. If you have your Bibles, open to Genesis chapter 1. You guys got chapter 21, I'm sorry. You guys got that? I'll give you guys a second. You guys just say amen. Anyone got a Bible? Now, I don't believe that message about you ain't got a Bible because you guys got phones with applications on them. So go ahead and pull those out too.
Amen.
I got like one amen. Come on. Genesis 21. We're looking at verse 17 to 20. All right, you guys ready?
Amen.
Verse 17 says, and God heard the voice of the boy. And the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, what troubles you, Hagar? Fear not, for God has heard the voice of the boy where he is. Up, lift up the boy and hold him fast with your hand, for I will make him into a great nation. First of all, he's reaffirming the promise that he already made. Ishmael has waited 16 years possibly, at least 16 years, of hearing about the promise that his mom has told him. And now God shows up and he's saying, no, I'm reaffirming that promise. There is a promise on your life, right? Not only does he reaffirm that promise, but verse 19, this is the key verse. It says, then God opened up her eyes and she saw a well of water. And she went and filled the skin with water and gave the boy a drink. Here's why this is significant. In the Bible, the Spirit of God is always compared to water. We need water to survive, right? Are you guys listening? You guys follow me?
Yeah.
Come on. Yeah? Come on, earlier, a few people. Come on. You guys with me?
Yeah.
We need water to survive, right? When God made us, he put his Spirit into us and it gave us life. Jesus says that whoever believes in me will have waters of everlasting life welling up inside water them so they will never be thirsty. But he's talking about their soul. He's not necessarily talking about drinking water. Listen to this. Ishmael is thirsty, and God knows this. And he opens up Hagar's eyes, and Hagar doesn't go and just get a drink for herself. She gets the water, and she goes and takes it to her son. And then, what does it say right after that? And God was with the boy, and he grew up. The spirit is always compared to water. We, in this case, Ishmael drinks the water, and it says God was with him after that. When we encounter the spirit of God, he is with us after that. Are you guys following what I'm saying? The Spirit of God, young man right here, the Spirit of God is with you if you have encountered him. He wants to take you somewhere. He has a promise, and God reaffirmed that promise, and he's probably affirming something in your life, and as soon as he's done reaffirming that, he's going to say, and I'm going to walk with you. I'm going to be right by your side. Do you believe that, man?
Yes, I do.
He's speaking that to you right now, and he wants somebody else in this room to know that he's going to walk with you. But do you believe that his spirit's going to fill you up? Do you believe that as soon as you encounter that spirit, that your entire life is going to change? Do you believe that?
Yes.
Do you believe that?
Amen.
I can't lie. I have been going through a difficult time in my life. This past week, I almost found no motivation to go to work because I'm like, I don't want to do this anymore. I don't want to make sandwiches for jerks. I don't want to work with people who try to take charge and they're not even in charge. I don't want to be there. But God reminded me through Gideon right over here, because this has happened. This girl at work, last week, she came up to me and she said, she knows I'm a Christian. She said, what do you know about demons? I was like, the heck? She ain't a Christian. And I said, I know some stuff. Why? She said, I think a demon is following me. Can you pray for me? I was like, what the heck? I said, tell me what's going on. She said, well, when I'm at home, sometimes I'll hear somebody calling my name, or and no one's home, or I'll see a shadowy figure late at night, or I'll hear someone knocking on the window, and it's not like a tap, it's like a tap, 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 tap. She's like, it's like somebody's making a beat. But it just doesn't stop, and it freaks me out. And she said, one time I saw a little girl in my room. She's like, could it just be a ghost? I said, nah, ghost ain't real, that's a demon. I said, I'm gonna pray for you. I said, but I want you to pray yourself. Call out to Jesus every time you see that. My point isn't so much with her story, my point is with mine, is that I've forgotten that there's a calling on my life because of the wilderness season that I'm in. And I've forgotten that God's trying to push me somewhere, like my man over here reminded me today, that sometimes the pulpit, like what I felt like I was called to, isn't the place necessarily where we speak the word. Sometimes it's with the people that we know right there. Either if they're a Christian and they're struggling, or maybe they ain't a Christian, but everyone's struggling, right? And God wants to use you. He has a promise on your life. And that promise isn't just so you could do whatever you want and you could make money and you could have that dream job. I have to be reminded of that. That promise is that you're going to change people's lives. Do you believe that?
Yes.
Let me tell you, as I'll close on this, let me tell you how God has been fulfilling that promise in me. I told you I was a spoken word artist. I put down the mic and I walked away from it. Because I said, I feel like God's calling me to full-time ministry. I went in, and that didn't work. And I came out, and I said, God, like, what am I supposed to be doing? And all of a sudden, all these lyrics start coming up. All these lyrics start coming up. And I'm like, man, I haven't wrote like this in a long time. And then God starts putting in my heart. Now, I don't consider myself an MC. I'm a poet. But God starts putting in my heart, you need to make music. You need to make hip-hop music. You need to make music that's going to resonate with people. All of a sudden, and these are things I've been praying for years. God puts one of my boys in my life. He used to work for Capitol Records. Doesn't work there anymore. He's a producer. He's been teaching me everything I need to know about production. Does anyone know who Propaganda is? Want to know who Propaganda is? My boy, Ro, used to rap with him. I didn't know this. I've known Ro for years. Start talking with him. He says, I feel like God's told me to tell you that I'm supposed to help you with your music. This guy is good. I need you to understand that he is dope. He's like, I feel like God's telling me that I need to help you with your music. God is opening up this door
release an EP, and I'm thinking, eh, no one's gonna like it. I got such a good reaction that I had people emailing me and contacting me on SoundCloud, all this stuff. So they're asking me, when are you gonna make more music? When are you gonna make more music? When are you gonna make more music? My point in telling you this is so you guys go out, look at my music. I don't really care about that. What I care about saying is that God put a promise on my life, and I almost forgot because of that wilderness season, and he's reaffirming it right here to me right now as I'm even talking. He is reaffirming that, and he's reaffirming that to you. Do you believe that?
Yes.
Let's pray. Father God, you have your way in our lives. If there's anyone here who has lost sight of the promise, I pray you would reaffirm that to them. Maybe they feel like they've never heard a promise. I pray you speak that to them right now. Whatever it is. But sometimes we gotta wait, God. We have to wait to see that promise manifest. Ishmael had to wait almost 16 years. But you fulfilled that. And it said you were with him. God, you were going to be with us if we would just believe. Thank you, Jesus.